Welcome back, friends. Now, in this session, we continue with anesthesia in specific situation. I'm going to talk in detail about anesthesia for laparoscopic surgeries. Modern surgical endoscopic procedures are aimed at reducing trauma, mortality and morbidity, and also the cost of the patient. So, in turn, anesthetist has to keep pace with these new recent advances and provide safe anesthesia and even safer recovery. Thus, laparoscopy, which has been devised recently, ensures patient has reduced trauma, there is no mortality, reduced morbidity and also the cost, and also it provides cosmetic look to the surgery. Hence, anesthetist has to develop his skills so as to provide safer anesthesia and safer recovery to these patients. Now, pathophysiology for laparoscopic surgeries. Laparoscopic surgeries requires production of pneumoperitoneum, that is, insufflate the abdominal cavity with gas so as to produce pneumoperitoneum. It can be done in Trendelenburg position or reverse Trendelenburg position, and it is due to this pneumoperitoneum which is the mainstay for laparoscopic surgeries, that various physiological changes takes place in the body, and anesthetist has to take into account these physiological changes and give anesthesia appropriately so that there is no complication in the patient's health. Now, how do you produce pneumoperitoneum? Normally, pneumoperitoneum is produced by surgeons. I'm just going to list out the procedure how pneumoperitoneum is produced. First, stomach is decompressed by using orogastric tube or keeping the patient NBM for at least 5 to 6 hours. Catheterization is done. Veres needle, it's a small needle, it's inserted in subumbilical site with a click. Surgeon does that, he gets a definite click. This shows that that surgeon has entered intra-abdominal cavity, it has pierced the peritoneum and reached intra-peritoneum or intra-abdominal cavity or inside the peritoneum. Now, gas is insufflated at the rate of around 2 to 3 liters per minute till abdominal cavity distance. Once established flow, once the intra-abdominal cavity enlarges and pneumoperitoneum is established, gas flow is reduced to around 200 to 300 ml per minute. And it is maintained, abdominal pressure has to be maintained at around 14 to 20 mm of mercury. This is the procedure of producing pneumoperitoneum. For any laparoscopic surgery, before the start of the surgery, this is the main procedure, that is creation of pneumoperitoneum with the help of Veres needle at the subumbilical site. Insert the Veres needle perpendicular to the skin till you get a definite click. That means surgeon has entered the peritoneal cavity. Once the surgeon has entered the peritoneal cavity, gas is insufflated at the rate of around 2 to 3 liters per minute till intra-abdominal cavity pressure increases and there is gaseous distension or pneumoperitoneum is produced in the intra-peritoneal cavity, and then it is maintained, gas flow is maintained as around 200 to 300 ml per minute and abdominal pressure is maintained at around 14 to 20 mm of mercury. Now, normally, what are the gases used? Previously, room air has been used for producing pneumoperitoneum. However, there are some problems with using room air. The main problem by using room air is there is frequent migration of air to the scrotum or to the neck or to the mediastinum. Hence, pneumoperitoneum is not just pneumoperitoneum of intra-abdominal cavity, but also there is swelling in the scrotal region or neck swelling. Air embolism forms a major risk if room air is employed. Hence, room air is reserved for small laparoscopic procedures like laparoscopic TL done in small centers. Oxygen, this was also previously used, but the major problem with using oxygen for creating pneumoperitoneum is it may cause explosion with cautery, as cautery is effectively used and readily used during laparoscopic surgery, and also chances of air embolism increase with the use of oxygen. Nitrous oxide, it was also previously used. However, even in case of nitrous oxide, there is a risk of intraperitoneal explosion, as nitrous oxide can combine with methane gas released from the bowel. Carbon dioxide, it is mostly preferred to create pneumoperitoneum recently because it is odorless, non-combustible, it is non-toxic, it is readily available. Blood gas solubility coefficient is around 0.8 and it is readily buffered by bicarbonate in the blood and is removed by lungs. Thus, CO2, which serves all the purpose, that is, it is more odorless, non-combustible, non-toxic, it is readily available, blood gas solubility is around 0.8 and readily buffered with bicarbonate and removed from the lungs. Thus, CO2 is the most preferred gas used to create pneumoperitoneum for any laparoscopic surgeries. Now, what are the changes after, just as I mentioned, once you create pneumoperitoneum, intra-abdominal cavity pressure increases by about 14 to 20 millimeter of mercury. It causes various physiological changes. To list a few, I just mentioned respiratory changes which occur. There is increase in the PaCO2, that is carbon dioxide concentration increases. Hence, it affects the choice of anesthesia, duration and patient. The amount of PaCO2 or CO2 increase depends on what type of anesthesia you employ, duration of surgery and also the patient status of the patient, systemic status of the patient. There is decrease in functional residual capacity of lung as happened with pregnant females. So therefore, it results in ventilation perfusion mismatch and pneumothorax is common. Gas embolism is an added risk factor when you create pneumoperitoneum. Other cardiovascular changes which occur with pneumoperitoneum are, there is decreased cardiac output, increase in the arterial pressure and increase in systemic vascular resistance and peripheral vascular resistance. Arrhythmias are common when pneumoperitoneum is ensued, and also there is reflex increase in vagal tone. So to mention the major points or major changes that occur in respiratory system and cardiovascular system, they are as follows. In the respiratory system, there is increase in PaCO2, hence it also depends, the amount of increase in PaCO2 depends on the choice of anesthesia, patient, systemic status of the patient and duration of surgery. There is decrease in functional residual capacity of the lung. Also, there are chances of ventilation perfusion mismatch, air and gas embolism chances increases. Also, there is possibility of pneumothorax. Talking in terms of cardiovascular changes, there is decrease in cardiac output, increase in the arterial pressure, increase systemic vascular resistance and arrhythmias. Also, there is reflex increase in vagal tone. Other complications or other changes, physiological changes which occur are hypoxia. This happens due to respiratory changes. Hypothermia, if at all the laparoscopic procedure is prolonged, this may lead to hypothermia of the patient. Stress response is common phenomena leading to hyperglycemia, leukocytosis and fever. Vascular injury is common due to technical problem or technical flaws from the surgeon's point of view. Nausea and vomiting is obviously present in about 90 to 95% patients, and deep vein thrombosis is also one of the complications. Now, what are the contraindications for laparoscopic surgeries? The main contraindications for using laparoscopic surgeries are blood dyscrasias, any obstructive lung disease, recent MI or myocardial infarction, acute abdominal or diaphragmatic hernia, massive ascites, congestive heart failure and extensive organomegaly in the intra-abdominal cavity. These are some of the conditions which are due to which laparoscopic surgery is contraindicated due to obvious lesion. Blood dyscrasias is obvious. You cannot have laparoscopic surgery in a patient who is suffering from blood dyscrasias. Obstructive lung disease is a contraindication because with the creation of pneumoperitoneum, you reduce the functional residual capacity and residual volume of the lung. Thus, added insult can happen in patient with obstructive lung disease. Recent MI is a contraindication not only for laparoscopic surgery but for any form of surgery unless surgery is life-saving. Acute abdomen, in cases of acute abdomen, it is very difficult to induce pneumoperitoneum, hence laparoscopic surgery is contraindicated. Massive ascites, for obvious reason, you cannot create pneumoperitoneum and hence it is contraindicated. Congestive heart failure and extensive organomegaly are some of the other contraindications. Anesthesia technique which is employed for laparoscopy, general laparoscopic surgeries, general anesthesia is the most preferred method. Premedication in laparoscopic surgeries is done with an antacid or antiemetic. stomach is emptied with the help of orogastric tube. Clonidine may be used to decrease the stress response. Narcotics are avoided because of narcotics, it may lead to postoperative nausea and vomiting. Hence, narcotics are avoided during laparoscopic surgeries. Induction, how do you induce a patient in laparoscopic surgeries? It is simple, deflate the stomach with the help of Reye's tube. Smooth induction with endotracheal intubation and controlled ventilation. Providing good muscle relaxation, controlled ventilation, complete analgesia and no risk of operation. And a very still operative field. These are basically the goals of laparoscopic surgery. Induction should be smooth with tracheal endotracheal intubation, controlled ventilation, provide good muscle relaxation so that surgeon will be able to maneuver abdominal cavity very easily with smooth relaxation and complete analgesia. There should not be any risk of aspiration and operative field should be as still as possible. All these goals are achieved by giving general anesthesia with controlled ventilation. When you are giving general anesthesia with controlled ventilation, maintain ETCO2 at around 35 mm of mercury. This can be monitored on a capnograph. 15-20% increase in minute volume is achieved by increase in respiratory rate rather than increase in tidal volume. Because of presence of ETCO2, there are chances that PO2 may fall. But to counter that, you have to increase the minute volume, and to increase the minute volume, you have to increase the respiratory rate rather than increasing the tidal volume, as mentioned in one of my previous topics. Other techniques which can be used for laparoscopy are laryngeal mask airway. This can be used for short procedures, but there is always a risk of aspiration while doing laparoscopic surgeries with LAMA or laryngeal mask airway. Local anesthesia can be employed, for example, with laparoscopic TL, and regional anesthesia like epidural anesthesia can be employed for pelvic procedures for laparoscopic surgeries. Recently, even cholecystectomy, laparoscopic cholecystectomy and laparoscopic appendicectomy has been done with under epidural anesthesia. However, preferred method is general anesthesia to achieve all the goals of laparoscopy. What are the monitors required? During laparoscopic surgery, you have to monitor blood pressure, pulse oximeter, ECG, capnography and CVP if possible. So these are the goals of laparoscopic surgeries. It is forming the mainstay of surgical practice nowadays, and we have to keep pace with the goals of laparoscopic surgeries. It could be easily achieved taking proper care and proper pre-medication with proper induction dose and proper reversal. So the main goal, I will repeat again, smooth induction with endotracheal intubation and controlled ventilation without risk of aspiration and a complete and still operative field, which can be easily achieved by general anesthesia, which is the preferred method with controlled respiration. Coming to anesthesia for elderly, now other specific situations, I am going to briefly mention what all things you are supposed to do and what are the things you are supposed to avoid in some specific situations. For example, anesthesia for elderly. If an elderly patient is being posted for some surgery and you are supposed to anesthetize the patient, elderly patient require less dose of anesthetic drug. You should always keep in mind, as the patient grows old, the amount of drug or the dose of drug required for induction, for maintenance and for reversal will be drastically reduced. So this important point, all anesthetists should always keep in mind, that elderly persons will require less anesthetic drug as compared to a normal person. They are more prone for post-operative delirium. Elderly person, as they grow old, there are some hormonal changes, there is some neurological problems. So whenever you induce and reverse these patients, they are prone to get post-operative delirium, and you should be aware of that. Intensive monitoring required during surgery because of their systemic status. As the patient grows old, the cardiovascular system, respiratory system and all other system have some form of problem, some problem or other. Hence, anesthetist should be always awake, should be alert, and because in case of elderly patients, sudden complication can arise anytime and you should be prepared to deal with them. So this is a special mention for anesthesia in elderly patient. Now talking about anesthesia in renal failure patients, like patients who are having renal failure, who are on dialysis, are posted for some other surgeries. Like say for example, patient with renal failure is posted for appendectomy, emergency appendectomy, or posted for emergency acute abdomen, gastric duodenal perforation, or some other patient, you should take into consideration following points. Avoid following inhalational agents, that is enfluorine, sevoflurane and methoxyflurane, because these inhalational agents are nephrotoxic and should not be administered in a renal failure patient. In a patient with renal failure, always prefer atracurium or vicuronium to pancuronium, because these drugs are of these drug act of small duration, and in case of renal failure, as kidney itself is in doldrums, now if you use pancuronium, the major site of excretion of pancuronium is kidneys, hence the duration of block may increase and patient may not be able to be awakened after the surgery. Hence you always prefer atracurium or vicuronium to pancuronium in a patient with renal failure. Always monitor blood urea nitrogen, serum creatinine and urine output in renal failure patient, and try to maintain these three parameters as normal as possible, or try to maintain these monitors preoperatively, as close to preoperative level as possible. Now to mention about anesthesia in asthmatic patient, proper care which you are supposed to take are: induction should always be done with ketamine and propofol. You should ketamine or propofol. You should avoid thiopentone for inducing patients suffering with bronchial asthma. Most muscle relaxant which is used or preferred are pancuronium or vicuronium. Volatile agents like halothane inhibit laryngeal and pharyngeal reflexes, hence it's preferred. And also halothane may sometimes cause bronchodilation, which is helpful in asthmatic patient. So in patients suffering from asthma, if he is posted for some other surgeries, and if you are supposed to give GA for that, these particular patients, always keep in mind, induce the patients with ketamine. This is important from MCQ point of view. In an asthmatic patient, induction is always done with ketamine or propofol, but thiopentone sodium is always avoided. Muscle relaxants which can be used are pancuronium and vicuronium, and volatile agents, in case of volatile agents, halothane is drug of choice because it inhibits laryngeal and pharyngeal reflexes and also causes bronchodilation. Now anesthesia in daycare surgery or ambulatory surgery, this is the mainstay nowadays recently, because patients do not have much time. They want to get their surgery done and go back home as quickly as possible, preferably by the evening patient is back to his house. So this form of anesthetist has to keep pace with this form of surgery, which is called ambulatory surgery, and this is also called as daycare surgery. In such cases, induction should be done with propofol, because propofol has short half-life, induction is very smooth, fast, rapid, and propofol is excreted very rapidly from the body. Hence, patient comes out or awakens from anesthesia very early, as early as 2 to 3 hours after the operation. Hence, induction in daycare surgery should always be done by propofol. Volatile agent of choice is isoflurane or sevoflurane, because it does not remain in body and it is easily excreted from the lungs. Hence, there are no residual effects. So, patient can come out of the effects of these volatile agents as quickly as possible. Also, analgesics like alfentanil and fentanyl are preferred over other agents, because they do not cause respiratory depression and also they do not cause any serious sedation. Muscle relaxant of choice is mivacurium or atracurium. The reason for using this is same, that it does not cause any residual effects. So in daycare surgery or ambulatory surgery, anesthetic should always remain. You should use drugs which are short acting, quick and easily excreted from the body, having no residual effects in the body, thus helping the patient get back to work as quickly as possible. So In this module, I have completed or I have tried to complete some specific considerations. I have completed anesthesia for laparoscopic surgeries. In specific situations, I have completed obstetric anesthesia, anesthesia for LS, lower segment caesarean section, anesthesia for labor analgesia, anesthesia in elderly, anesthesia in renal failure patients, in asthmatics and daycare anesthesia. I have tried to cover each and everything. However, there are some points which are still missing, which may be covered at a later stage. But always keep in mind, giving anesthesia or in specific consideration, you should take care of patient's age, sex, nature of surgery, duration of surgery, what actually the surgeon needs and what actually the patient needs. Taking into consideration all these factors, combine all these factors together and decide your plan of action to give proper anesthesia which is safe and even safer recovery to the patient, so that patient and surgeon has no problems. Thank you very much.